Hey guys, welcome back to the channel. Today on Tundra Tactical, we're going to be covering that glorious speech that our fearless leader gave on our nation's birthday. So stay tuned, thanks for watching, and let's start the show. We recently celebrated our nation's Independence Day, and on that day, the leader of the free world held a great event to help us commemorate the new world's exodus from the binds of taxation without representation. I dare say the snake on my Gadsden flag shed a tear when the president made mention of the oft-forgotten seizures of the airports during the Revolutionary War. Now I encourage you to join me as we relive one of those historic battles. The air was especially warm for early June in 1776 outside of what we now consider to be Washington, D.C. The sweet smell of pretzels from a nearby kiosk tickled the noses of hungry patriots who were preparing for what would be their final attack on Dulles Airport. While Reagan National had been used as a foothold for months, the revolutionaries knew that it was clearly inferior. With the grimier feeling, the crappy airlines, and the inferior concessions scattered throughout the terminals, Dulles was clearly the prize of the District of Columbia, and Sherwin Williams, a young officer who has seen more bloodshed at the age of 28 than most people have ever seen in their entire lifetime, was charged with liberating it from the British swine. The obvious maneuver is to take the ticketing counters by force and then storm security before infiltrating the terminals. While this was considered doctrine by many armies at the time, as Sherwin-Williams was aware, this is what those dirty redcoats were expecting. Williams cleverly instructed his soldiers to download the Sun Country app and check in on their phones, allowing them to bypass the ticketing counter altogether, taking a large number of those limey bastards out of the fight altogether. Another implementation that Williams made on the eve of battle would alter doctrine of the American forces forever. All subordinate leaders ensured that their soldiers had their military IDs and orders on their person, which would allow them to use the clear lane and bypass a large number of travelers at the security checkpoint. This would be the first documented use of what we now call pre-combat checks, or PCCs. While many battles in the Revolutionary War were fought at sunrise with the attacking force proceeding from the east, putting the sun in the eyes of the defending force, well, security didn't open till 9, so this advantage was lost. Still, the preparations made by Williams' men paid off as they made it to the terminal nearly undetected, with only minor casualties, as some men did have flasks containing more than 100 milliliters of fluid. A rare oversight by Sherwin-Williams. But still, they pressed on. The foothold was gained in Starbucks while a reconnaissance force was dispatched to Sbarro's, Auntie Annie's, and the less fortunate team was sent to Hudson News. The scouts sent to the pretzel stand did run into some resistance in the form of an out-of-service escalator, but the promise of unlimited free nacho cheese with the purchase of a regular menu item urged them onwards. Their ingenuity allowed them to use the escalator as if it were stairs. From this point, supplies and intelligence were gathered and sent back to Starbucks, where Williams learned of the Redcoat stronghold in the Delta Sky Club. Of course, this was the perfect place for an occupying force to remain. While the club promised free snacks and 2 free rail drinks to service members, nobody ever refuses booze to a soldier in the Sky Club, regardless of their national affiliation. This is where Williams found his first disadvantage. He thought he was getting a great deal by booking with Sun Country, only to find out that in addition to irregular flight schedules, and let's be honest, uncomfortable seats, there was no equivalent stronghold to the Sky Club sponsored by Sun Country. It seems that the Brits did have the logistical advantage, and if they were able to defend the Sky Club, they could sustain themselves indefinitely on the salad bar and cheap gin held within. Thinking quickly, Williams determined that a direct assault on the Sky Club would be foolish, as the woman at the desk near the door was sure to check IDs and would certainly notify the British officers of the Patriots' arrival, spoiling the whole attack. No. A diversion was required to lure the bastards out. Burgundy's Gold Club, a bar catering to Washington Redskins fans, was where the first real combat of the day was had. Sherwin's men needed drinks to pull off this diversion, and Burgundy's had that in spades. 2 companies assaulted the bar by force, and while exorbitant airport prices on liquor created a tactical risk, there was a 2-for-1 on Bloody Marys that eased the blow to our Patriots. Once Baker and Frog Snack Company had taken the hometown hero's bar by force, news quickly spread across the terminal that authorities were needed to retake Burgundy's, and this included the Redcoats. In a diary found decades later, one junior British officer charged with the security of the sports bar was planning on sending a commemorative RG3 lapel pin to his wife. I wonder if she ever received it. As hasty orders were issued to platoons of British soldiers to immediately surge into the sports bar previously held by them, the ill-prepared Redcoats were easy targets for the already-in-place men of William's battalion. Snipers from the hot dog stand were able to pick off British officers. Sappers used covers behind the stand that sells soggy pre-made sandwiches and plain coffee to scout and destroy avenues of approach by creating obstacles with large groups of tourists spread across the entire walkway and the people that walk slower than tectonic plates. Patriot cavalry used luggage carts to increase their movement speed and were able to intercept British skirmishers. The hallways were strewn with novelty t-shirts and overpriced tchotchkes. The battle for Burgundy's became so challenging for the British that they'd forgotten to leave a defensive contingent at the Delta Sky Club. This folly was to be their undoing as Williams and his two remaining companies attacked in force. When the lady at the desk of the club that asked for tickets and IDs was overwhelmed by the patriotic marauders because they asked so politely if they could just get drinks with their IDs, even though they didn't have a Delta ticket, she was forced to allow three at a time, but the crafty revolutionaries were able to sneak in entire platoons at a time, simply by moving when she wasn't looking. It was no time at all until the British commander was in custody, and his bowl of popcorn with his Delta brand IPA was delivered to Sherwin Williams. Williams would later forward these concessions on to General Washington as evidence of the victory, and to bring encouragement to the men who were yet preparing for the attack on Logan International. God bless America, and God bless her airports. If you dislike this video, then you probably should get a better grade than we did in American history. But if you like the video, make sure to smash that thumbs up button and share it around with your friends. Consider subscribing to our channel and checking out our Patreon page to stay up to date on current and future content. And thanks for watching, guys. You can now find us on Instagram at Tundra Tactical MN.